So with a new manager and front office, there's a good chance that the Mets lineup could look a little bit different this season. According to Tim Healy of Newsday, the Mets are considering the possibility of moving Brandon Nimmo out of the leadoff spot this season. When asked about the potential change, Nimmo explained that he's not opposed to that being changed at all. I'm not stuck on that to have to be the leadoff hitter. We didn't reach the expectations that we wanted last year, and I'm okay with shaking things up to reach a different result. Last year, Nimmo continued a career power surge last season with career highs in extra base hits, home runs, average exit velocity, max exit velocity, hard hit rate, and barrel rate across 451 batted ball events. Mets manager Carlos Mendoza confirmed that moving Nimmo down in the lineup is an option, but if everybody is healthy, Nimmo will be in the leadoff spot for now. In the leadoff position, Nimmo has slashed a career 273, 375, 455 with a 134 weighted runs created plus across over 2,300 plate appearances.
This was something that we had talked about a couple weeks ago, kind of jokingly a little bit, you know, because of the power surge that Brandon Nimmo had, especially just in comparison to the rest of the lineup. And, you know, while I think that, you know, we were joking the idea of like maybe bat Nimmo cleanup, I don't think that's going to happen, but I do think there is a case to be made for him batting second or even third. I know that, you know, Francisco Lindor has been batting second quite a bit this spring training. He did it again this past game. And, you know, Keith was talking about the idea of, okay, well, you have a guy stealing bases at the top of the lineup. And you look at someone like Starling Marte, who in 86 games stole 24 bases, compared to Brandon Nimmo, 152 games, he stole 3 bases. We know that Starling Marte has the ground ball problem. So if you are going to have Nimmo bat leadoff and have Marte bat second, Nimmo's going to stay at first. He's not going to steal. Marte's going to ground out into probably a lot of double plays. So you're wasting a lot of Brandon Nimmo's just on base, just the times that he gets on base. But if you put Marte first, when he gets on, he steals. And now Nimmo's in a situation where, okay, he has a guy in scoring position. Or if you have Francisco Lindor in front of Nimmo, now you have multiple guys in scoring position because Marte and Lindor are going to run. So now they just have so many more just RBI opportunities, just better situations to score runs than they did previously. Like now you have Alonso with a guy on base instead of Marte wiping them off of the board, you know? And I just think that pitchers would have to approach these guys a lot differently. I mean, facing Nimmo with two runners on or a runner in scoring position is different than facing Nimmo with nobody on, you know? So I think that when you look at the way the lineup just performed this past season, and you had Alonso, Lindor, Alvarez, and Nimmo as your top four power guys, there was a major drop-off after Brandon Nimmo. I mean, like, the rest of these guys weren't even close to the home runs that that top four was hitting. So we also saw Alvarez bat after Alonso today. So if you're looking at something that's like Marte, Lindor, Nimmo, Alonso, Alvarez, I mean, maybe, you know, because I think that when you look at it, they haven't added any real, obviously, bats to this team. They got Tyrone Taylor and Harrison Bader for fielding purposes. But I think that if you want to actually see a change in the offense, you might have to actually change where these guys are batting in the lineup to see that. You know, so I think that it's a matter of trying to, like we say, put guys in positions where they're most successful. I mean, if Nimmo isn't going to be stealing bases anyway, and he's just going to be one of your best overall hitters, I'm not totally opposed to him batting third. I think that, you know, you have the lineup, like we've talked about before, you have so many different leadoff hitters that it could still work out, you know? So I think that I'm not against it at all. I think if this team gets off to a slow start and they're doing the usual, like, Nimmo, Marte, 1-2, I'm totally fine with them trying to switch up if Marte is just going to keep grounding out and just having Nimmo not be a factor. Because what's the point of Nimmo getting on base if he doesn't get to stay there? So I like it. I'm definitely totally open-minded to it, and I'm curious to see if they actually do something like
that. I'm also really intrigued by this idea. That being said, I kind of feel like, for me, the ideal lineup would be Nimmo at 1, Alonso at 2, and then Pete is protected by Lindor, Alvarez, Vientos. I really think that Alonso at 2 should be a staple like no matter what he bats to. So many of the best teams in baseball bat their best hitters in the top two, some in the three hole, which is fine as well. But I want Pete getting as many plate appearances as possible, and I want him to have power protection. That being said, Nimmo doesn't have to bat one in that case if Pete is at two. Starling Marte or Jeff McNeil, for me, make interesting potential leadoff hitters. From the standpoint that I feel like Jeff McNeil, down the line of last season, he was starting to pull some more fly balls. I don't necessarily think that he's a power hitter, because obviously he's not a power hitter. But there could be more room for Jeff to get a hold of some fastballs, or because he can be a leadoff hitter. He's been that. But what intrigues me more is Starling Marte, because he is still is a big stolen base threat. And with Pete right behind him, he'd have all the other power hitters protecting him. And Nimmo, at this point, he has said that he wants to hit the 30 home run threshold. I think that's a realistic milestone he can reach. He has tons of raw power. He has a great swing. He pulls fly balls. He's starting to hit more fly balls in general. I don't see that as a super unrealistic possibility. And he's not going to have to play center field, which is a very difficult position to play and takes a toll on your body. I still think Nimmo 1 and Alonso 2 would be my ideal lineup. But if not, I think Marte or Jeff could make interesting leadoff hitters, with Pete following, and then maybe Nimmo at 3 or Lindor at 3 or Nimmo at 4, Alvarez at 5. And you never know what Mark Vientos could. If Mark Vientos has a good season, I think that could be upwards of 25 to 30 home runs as well, if enough goes right. So I definitely understand this consideration. And, you know, maybe Nimmo isn't a stereotypical leadoff hitter anymore. And I think that's for the better of this lineup, especially this lineup.
Just to actually add on to what you said about McNeil, his big power surge in 2019 in the second half was when he was the leadoff hitter. And how many of those home runs that he hit were first pitch of the game fastballs that he was just pulling over the right field wall that Brandon Nimmo was a lot of times taking? So, you know, we talk so much about, you know, this new era of baseball. You put powers in leadoff spot. You start games up 1-0. I'm not opposed to McNeil batting leadoff either, but what I think goes against Jeff with this particular team is how right-handed dominant they are. I mean, you don't forget that Bader's a starter. He's batting right-handed. Obviously, you have Vientos. You have Alvarez. You have Marte. You have Alonso. So all of a sudden, if you put McNeil at the top two, now your only lefty you have towards the bottom is Beatty and just a bunch of righties. So I don't know if they're going to want to split those guys up a little more. Again, to me, I've never been a believer of that. I've just been a believer of whatever generates the most offense, just put your best hitters to the top and score runs. That's all I care about. But now, a lot of days, these philosophies, this whole lefty-righty stuff, I don't know if they're going to put Jeff to the top plus Nimmo to the top. I think, you know, that might be this can get a little weird, because if you're going something like Neil, then you're going Alonso, then Nimmo, then Lindor, and then, like, you know, Marte gets, like, towards 8 or whatever. Like, it could get a little weird just with the current team they have now, but it's something that could work, though. And, I mean, the way I see it is that with Nimmo, it's like he hit 24 home runs last year. These other guys can't do that. Like, it would take something crazy for McNeil to get to that standpoint. We know Beatty's not doing it. We know Bader's not doing it. So it's like, if he's one of your only guys who can do it, why not put him in a power position? You know, I mean, that's just the way I look at it. Because with these other guys, it's like, it would be a big jump for Vientos to get to 25. He has the power to do it. It's just a matter of actually doing it on the major league level. That's a massive jump for him. That's over double his output from last season. So I think that since Nimmo already has done it, I feel like, you know, you're not asking someone to do something they haven't done before. It's like Nimmo can already do it. You might as well just kind of put him in a spot in the order where that's, you know, very effective when you have guys on base. Because, I mean, what's the point of Brandon Nimmo being one of your top home run hitters if a lot of times he's going to have nobody on base and those are just solo home runs, you know? So I think, again, just trying to make the most out of your hitters on your current team is how they should be constructing this lineup.
Yeah, I really like what you said, because, you know, you're right. In 2019, when Jeff was hitting all those homers, it was in the one spot on first pitch fastballs down the middle. That is the most common first pitch. And I think in that case, I really am intrigued by, if we can maximize the power output of this offense, maybe that would be having McNeil in the leadoff spot. I'm not expecting 20 home runs or anything. Hell, 15 might even be a stretch. But, you know, 13? If we can get as much power out of this lineup as we possibly can and get McNeil, at the end of the day, he's a table setter. But in today's modern baseball, I don't think you need more than one table setter at the top of your lineup. And so I think McNeil would be a good spot for that. And while we're at it, me personally, I'm not that high on Jeff McNeil or Starling Marte as just hitters going into the 2024 season. But that being said, I do have a little more faith in Jeff McNeil's ability to bounce back from last season, simply because of age. Neither of them are young, but Marte definitely is towards those later 30s at this point. Jeff had a really good second half last year, so I think we just need to maximize the power output of this lineup, which is maybe that is having Jeff 1, and I think Alonso 2, and you can go from there.
Of course, I have to be the killer of all Jeff McNeil propaganda. Let me bring in the dose of reality of Jeff McNeil being the leadoff spot. The main reason why Jeff McNeil was in the leadoff spot in 2019 was because Nimmo was hurt. Also 2019. Juice ball era. Also in 2019, it was a 27-year-old Jeff McNeil. Now you're dealing with 32-year-old Jeff McNeil, who is coming off of an elbow injury, which we don't know how it did affect him. Also coming off bicep soreness. We have not seen him hit yet. I think that putting him in that position, coming off the year he just had, coming into the age that he's in, I would not do that. Now, also, regards to lowering Nimmo in the lineup, I despise this. I despise this idea more than ever. There's a reason as to why I do. This Mets lineup has been so inconsistent. They have been so frustrating, so streaky in the last 5 years. Why would you take the only position that has ever been reliable, Nimmo in the leadoff spot, and change that? God forbid, can't put Pete second. Good teams actually do. No, the Mets have to do it their own way because they're smarter than everyone else with how much they win. How I look at it is I only think that there's just about two different winning formulas with this lineup, especially the top of this lineup with how top heavy it is. It's either Nimmo, Lindor, Alonso, Alvarez, or it's Nimmo, Alonso, Lindor, Alvarez. Like, that's the only way that I look at it, because with Brandon Nimmo, I understand he doesn't steal bases. That's one of the main gripes of him as a leadoff hitter. He gets enough extra base hits to cover that up, of course. And then also, he's going to be registering more power, obviously, if he's going to go from the leadoff spot. I would love to get 30 home runs from that leadoff spot if he's going to do that. For me, I don't give a shit about table setters. Like, I really don't. Table setters deserve to be at the bottom. They get the least amount of plate appearances, and they set up the top of the lineup. I'm fine with that, obviously. And that's what it's going to probably look like with Bader at the bottom of the lineup. And, you know, we'll see where Marte bats. But for me, I don't need to take Brandon Nimmo out of the leadoff spot, which I like power out of. I'm not going to take Brandon Nimmo out of the leadoff spot to cater to McNeil and Marte, who recently have shown that they are a negative asset to this offense. And it's especially Marte. Like, McNeil, different story. Marte, what is he actually going to show you? Like, for me, yes, there's a possibility that he could bounce back. We have seen him at his very best. Great 2022. But what the hell is he going to do? Like, for me, I'm the most concerned about Starling Marte. And I don't, again, Frank, we've talked about this before. If we see Starling Marte batting second, like I've said, you're asking to lose, in my opinion.
Carson, where has he batted so far this spring training? It's like I told you. We agree there. When it
he's
comes
batted
to
third. He's batted third a few times. They won't put Alonso second, but they'll put Marte third.
So regardless, Marte
that's what pisses me off.
Marte will be in the top three, whether it's one, two, or three. He's going to be there. And again, it's because of contract and ego. I know you guys are number guys, like, especially because you think it's like interchangeable, like good player goes here, bad player goes there. Like, there's a lot more to it, you know, when it comes to these actual human beings they're getting, especially Marte as one of the highest paid guys on this team. Because he's a veteran and all that stuff, he's going to bat towards the top. And I disagree with it, but it's like the same thing we talked about with Cano when he was here. They're going to bat him to the top. And whether we agree or not, that's just reality of it. So
no, I know it's going to happen. Yeah.
So if he's going to be in the top three, I want him at one. because I think that he could be more of a negative asset with his ground ball problem at the 2 and 3 spot compared to him leading off and stealing base. So if he's forced to be in the top three, I want Marte at one. Because, again, I think Nimmo 1 and Marte 2, it does a disservice to Nimmo. And Nimmo's not able to be as productive as possible. And same with Pete. Pete cannot be as productive as possible if Marte's in the 2. So he blocks everyone from doing what they're most capable of. So if he needs to be at the top, just put him at 1. And if he gets on base, he's in scoring position because he's probably going to steal. But if not, it's like, why are you killing possible rallies by forcing him in that 2 spot?
Oh, yeah, of course. I do not want to see him in that 2 spot. Like, that's a bigger detriment to this entire lineup. His hitting profile, whether it's good or bad with Marte, it's a wrap. And you just don't know what's going to go on with him.
You can't project him because he's, especially with a compromised lower half as well. I mean, that's the other thing that also just kind of puts any projection all mixed up. When the guy, that's just, you don't know what his lower half is giving you.
My only point to putting him in the leadoff spot is that, again, if we're talking about instant offense from power, you're not going to get that from Marte. Also, I just don't think that you're going to get any real like leadoff production from a guy like Starling Marte, who's coming into a 35-year-old season. I mean, obviously, he is going to be in the top half of the lineup, of course. And I will add to that, because it's funny, because with Starling Marte, I just, the amount of, I don't know if it's loyalty or just contract loyalty they have. Last year, Starling Marte was horrendous. One of
and
the worst.
Never move from that.
And they're like, okay, you know what? Let's just move him to 5. Let's move him to 6. We're not going to lower him to that lower third. It's just, it drives me crazy. You look at all these other teams that put their best power hitter at number 2, or put a balanced hitter that can hit for contact and power, like at Ozzie Albies or something like that, at the top of their lineup. Somebody who's just an incredible 40-40 threat, like Ronald Acuna, with somebody like that, or a Mookie Betts or whatever. Obviously, we don't have those caliber of players, but Brandon Nimmo is the closest thing to it. There's only a few combinations that can help you win, especially with how top-heavy it is. Like, and I know that Marte is going to be batting second on opening day. I know damn well it's going to happen, but I'm still going to complain about it until they actually fix it. Because with Pete Alonso and the whole situation you put him in there, we need to get him up. Like Ro just said, changing him from 650 plate appearances to past 700 this year, it's too important. You need him up way more as compared to what he has been up to. Because obviously he's on the field every single day. So you're almost guaranteeing 700 plate appearances for him if he's fully healthy throughout the year. In the 2 spot, which...
And also, their plate appearances without Daniel Vogelback and Darren Ruff batting behind him. Like, they're more meaningful plate appearances. They're a plate appearance that he's going to be pitched differently than he was if he's batting fourth with a non-power third batting.
And Lindor behind him, or Alvarez behind him, they're feared hitters. Like, they are feared hitters.
What about Francisco Lindor leading off? He's done it before, did it his entire Cleveland career. Could hit for power.
Again, it's that then where does it's like we talked about, then where if Marte has to be in the top 3, then where does Nimmo go? Because then again, Alonso's not in the top 3.
My problem with Lindor in the leadoff spot is that as much of a longtime fan I am of Eric Chavez, he's going to tell him, you're the leadoff hitter, get on base. And that's going to diminish some of the power. That's how I feel about Lindor in the leadoff spot. And again, for me, what we've seen so far in spring, it doesn't seem like he has the same approach that he had last year, which I'm so happy. I don't know, Lindor and then Alonso, that could be something you could consider. But I just want to take away the double play. Like, that's the thing about me.
What I'm not crazy about Lindor, Alonso, 1-2s, I think the lineup gets so top-heavy. I think it really feels more so like once you get past those 2, it's just, I mean, like you have Nimmo, but it's like, I just feel like it really takes away from just how deep the lineup is. I think it's just too top-heavy. I don't think they have the bottom half to really complement the top half being just so strong in 1-2.
At the end of the day, I feel like what we should be doing is maximizing the power protection for Alonso. And Carson, like you and me, like we've been preaching all offseason for the Mets, like from Jock Peterson to Jorge Soler to the trade market. And moving Brandon Nimmo down the lineup would be a serious power threat protecting Alonso that wasn't doing so last year. So from that perspective, I think it has to make sense. And also, I'm not sure I'm completely on board with the notion that Marte is going to bat in the top 3. I think a lot of this, What I personally believe is that the Mets have, it seemed like a priority for the Mets to get him ramped up. And so that also could mean putting him at the top of the lineup in a spring training game, where he'd also have less innings on the field because he'd have his two plate appearances, and they could just take him out earlier in the game. And towards like last year, the Mets were not, he was not batting the top two after like a month. Like they moved him down. I don't remember exactly when.
He also was dead for half the season.
There's that too, but I feel like I'm not convinced that he's going to be batting in the top three. I think he could. There's definitely a chance.
I hope that these spring lineups are just to give him more ABs. Like, I really am just hoping. But again, he's still going to get the typical, no matter what, two or three plate appearances every single game, then they take him out of the game. So I don't know, but if I do see Marte in the top,
yeah, like, he had 43 games batting second, 5 batting fifth, 33 batting sixth, and 1 batting seventh.
One batting seventh? Yeah. Oh, man, we can't do that.
I mean, to me, with Marte, I think that since there isn't much power there, he to me, he's the ultimate table setter because of his stolen base. Like, that's the one thing that he's always going to do well is steal bases. I think if you're putting Marte seventh with like Beatty and Bader behind him, again, it's just kind of wasting him, in my opinion. Like, not that I just think that if he's not batting at the top of the lineup, he just shouldn't be in the lineup at all. That's just kind of how I see it.
If he's as healthy as he says he is, I would give him the green light to steal every single time from the bottom half of the order, of course. Because if you have him batting seventh and then you have Beatty behind him and Bader, just in general in Beatty, with Marte, let's say he leads off the inning, gets on base, walks or whatever, base hit, whatever, Beatty's grounding into a double play.
Yeah.
Almost like more than 60% of a chance that's happening. Marte can take second and take away the double play. I just want to take away the double play as much as I can.
That if you want that, that's why Marte would be batting first and not Nimmo. It would be less double plays.
Yeah, but then you'd also have from the bottom of the lineup as well. Like, that's the thing. Like, I'm trying to put Marte in the least amount of double play opportunities possible. He just destroys it.
If he's as healthy as he says he is, like we're saying, just put him on. Look, have Alonso behind him, have Nimmo behind Lindor, have all this power protection, have a pretty much a guaranteed stolen base if he gets on base because his jumps are incredible. Like, I think as long as Alonso isn't hitting fourth, for me, I will be happy. I don't see the upside in Pete Alonso hitting fourth.
I think Alonso a lot of times is batting fourth in this particular lineup by default. That's ultimately what I think it comes down to, is that, you know, like we talked about, especially when I think the other thing that's really messed us up too is the fact that Alvarez was batting ninth way too much, you know, and the fact that he's the third best power here, he shouldn't be batting ninth. So I think if you could actually make it to where Alvarez is batting, you know, fifth, fourth, whatever, it makes these things a lot easier. But even a lineup of, you know, Marte, then you're looking at Alonso, then Nimmo, then Lindor, then Alvarez. All of a sudden, it's like, wait a second. Okay, now you're kind of got something going on there. And I think we talked about Carson, like, way back with Alvarez not having given him the pressure of batting directly behind Alonso and batting cleanup at the start of the season. If you could kind of ease him in, like, okay, he's batting after Lindor and he's batting fifth, I think that's a really nice spot for him to kind of, you know, continue to improve and grow. And then it's like, okay, then you figure out, you know, McNeil, Vientos, and then you get that Beatty Bader. Like, I think that lineup just kind of flows a lot better. It still allows you to have Alonso bat second. And also Marte not granted double plays, but it means moving him off the third, off that leadoff spot. I just think that with the current team they have, I think there's more potential with Nimmo not batting leadoff. And it's not a knock on Nimmo. It's actually like a positive of him. I just think that with the current skill sets that it kind of – there's a scenario where it works out really well. And he could still do very good in the leadoff spot. But I just think that overall for the team, I think that he could be effective as a number three.
I personally think that with the 24 home runs he had last year, I think that that's kind of the power capacity with him.
Well, again, I think that he'd have a different approach too. You know, keep in mind that when he's batting leadoff, he's having a table set approach of taking pitches. I think that if you put him in a spot where he's going to have more opportunities to runners on base, he's going to be more aggressive. So I think if he's swinging the bat more, it gives him the opportunity to have more home runs. Like that's just like a simple, like, you know, cause and effect kind of thing.
I just don't see the reason as to, you've had so many combinations in years past. The only thing that has worked has been Nimmo in the leadoff spot. That's just been the case since he got up here. It's worked. Like, that's been the main thing, has worked, and he's continued to be a better player every single year. And I like Nimmo in that leadoff spot. He's the ideal leadoff hitter for me. He would be the leadoff hitter if he stole bases. The leadoff hitter in the game. He gets enough extra base hits to cover that. Not to mention with anybody coming from the bottom of the lineup that gets on base, God forbid, he's a good high leverage hitter as well. So I think that, I don't know, I think that giving Nimmo like almost a guarantee of getting 4 to 5 plate appearances a game, I think that that's something that's really beneficial. Not to mention the same thing with Alonso as well. I want to get most of it to Alonso as well. The best way to do that and have him up in the most opportunities is to have him batting second or even third, but him batting fourth of this, our best power hitter bats fourth. Leave that in 1978 where it belongs. You can't have a scenario where in the first inning, you don't have your big guns up because your top three hitters went down one. It just cannot happen.
You're correct. Brandon Nimmo in the leadoff spot has worked very well. That does not mean that a change wouldn't work well. Yeah, I just think there's a lot of possibilities, and I think this is something we should try.
I don't.
I think this is something we should try.
You know, I don't think there's many possibilities to win. Like, I just don't. Maybe if you believe in Marte bouncing back, or if you believe in McNeil bouncing back, or maybe Bader plays a little bit better than you expect, or Vientos breaks out, or Beatty finally figures it out. For me, I'm looking at it as four hitters at the top of this lineup, and the rest of it is death row at this current moment. That's how I see it going into the season. Maybe I get proven wrong. Maybe somebody is better than I expect them to be. But how I look at it right now is, it's way too top heavy, and you have to be top heavy to give your best hitters the most amount of plate appearances in that situation. Like Nimmo, Alonso, Lindor, and Alvarez, I want them up as much as possible because the rest of the friggin' lineup ain't gonna pull anyway. Like, I am not expecting them to do that. Whether they do or not, it's an added bonus. But going into this current situation, there's four hitters and then the misfits. To me, like, that's how I look at the lineup.
It's hard to win that way. It's really tough to win that way.
Yeah, obviously you need somebody to contribute, of course, from the bottom half of that lineup, but you're protecting Alonso, you're giving him a better shot. And, you know, for this offense, that's the main thing that I'm kind of worried about, of course, in the long stretch. But there's four hitters that I'm not really worried about, you know, stringing across the consistency. Not to mention, there's Alvarez, who we haven't really seen a consistent stretch from him yet either. So, you know, obviously, I think that he will figure it out. I think he's going to be a fantastic player. But again, there's a lot of uncertainty. And I think keeping what is certain at the top of the lineup is something that is really important, especially when our runs just come at such a premium without them. To watch the Mets offense when they're going well, you know, you're just seeing single after single after single or this error or whatever. Like, it's pulling teeth to actually give you consistent offense. And against high leverage velocity, it's just not going to work. The runs are going to come at such a big premium as compared to a typical offense that has that type of power. So I just need my biggest weapons, my best hitters, which are Lindor, Alonso, Nimmo, and Alvarez at the top of the lineup, no matter what. And I think the best combination is with Nimmo in the leadoff spot and Alonso right there behind him.